There are a lot of theories and a lot of arguments for and against the passage we're going to read in just a little bit. The centerpiece of the passage is going to be found in Isaiah chapter 7, verse 14. It's where we're introduced to Emmanuel. I believe it's appropriate for this season, and I'll admit it's calculated on my part. I didn't realize how easily it would fall into this series on the book of Isaiah. I didn't realize how timely it would be because I'm not that good of a planner. I don't plan things this well. The Lord had it planned out just perfect that last week we would talk about Isaiah 6 and talk about our calling and about how we are sent. When God says, whom shall I send? And each of us are to respond with, here am I, Lord, send me. And how timely that this very next chapter, chapter 7, which I'm going to talk to you about the historical context of it, but more so about the prophetic context of it. And so it's important that we address the advent of our Lord and Savior, the Messiah, Jesus Christ, through the words of the prophet Isaiah, which built for us words that we hear often, but we don't often hear them from Isaiah chapter 7. Frequently, we hear them from Matthew chapter 1, verse 23. That's where we frequently hear about it. So before we even go any further, I think it would be important that we set this up. Is this going to work, Caleb, you think? You got it set up and ready? Let's tell the story. Many of you have seen this. But let's tell the story through the words of children. Shall we? Watch this.
Came to see Mary.
She was doing laundry, and then the angel just appeared and she was really scared. So Gabriel was like, Mary, you're gonna have, Mary, you're gonna have a baby. You're gonna have a baby and you will call him Jesus. And then Mary was like, I'm not gonna have a baby yet. I'm only a teenager, I'm not married. Then the angel Gabriel told Joseph that Mary is not lying. You are having a new baby. And so they met up. They went to Bethlehem, which was Joseph's old town.
They ride a donkey.
I don't know.
A camel.
Oh, yeah, a camel.
She said, this donkey's fast. They tried to go to a hotel and
they asked the keeper for a place to stay. The keeper said,
we have no rooms. Literally, no rooms.
So Mary and Joseph walked away sadly, but then he said,
the only place here in Bethlehem that you can stay is a stable. And then he just pointed the way and they followed. When the shepherds were taking care of the sheep,
then they saw angels.
The angels said, a new baby is getting born, who is king of the Jews.
The angel were singing,
glorious. And then the shepherds said, I think we should go there and meet him. The second, I think, said, yeah, I agree with you. And the other said, yeah, me too. They had to walk through a bunch of grass and bushes, maybe have to camp out a night. Then the wise men heard about it.
And then a star appeared.
We should probably follow that star. It's pointing down to the barn.
So maybe we should follow it. Maybe. So the wise men went to Jesus.
They gave them gifts.
A stuffed animal, like a hippo one, to have at home.
Some diapers, and some wipes, and some milk, some shoes, some Jordans.
Gold ring and Latimer.
And I don't know how it would survive in that barn. Too stinky, too crowded, and ugh.
I think he probably pooped because the room was very smelly. Thank you for coming.
He's adorable.
He's gonna be our best friend.
I love you, and You the best baby I ever seen. There, I said it.
The new baby is gonna change the world.
Yeah. So you understand the story now? If you go on YouTube and you look up Christmas stories told through children. What? Christmas according to kids. You'll find several of those. There are many, and they are all hilarious. And they all have very similar actions. It's so good. I enjoyed it. So, that's that. I really like the part where he leans over and he goes, I love you, and you're the best baby I've ever seen. There, I said it. That's gorgeous. I love it. All right. Well, Advent is what we're talking about for just a moment here. The word Advent is a word which means the arrival of a notable person, thing, or event. In Latin, the term literally means coming. And so Advent means coming. And in our context, particularly, it means the coming of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Traditionally, it is observed the Sunday following Thanksgiving and weekly until the day of Christmas. It's a traditional observance that we used to observe here at the church for many years, and we refrained from doing so over the past couple years. Traditionally, we celebrate Advent by observing the lighting of candles and the reading of Scripture, and originally what we do is we'd have families come forward and read and light the candles, and the weekly themes point to the coming of the King. The weekly themes include hope and love and joy and peace, and then the incarnation or the light of the world candle is what it is. And so over the past few years, we've refrained from doing so, and I've thought about that. I wonder, why did we do that? And I would confess that one is because we changed the focus. We changed focus on what we were doing. We had a lot of things going on, and we changed focus. Another is because we became distracted. And then another reason is because we downplayed this season in response to guilt trips that were placed upon the church and Christianity as a whole today in the name of inaccuracy. In other words, people would say, well, Jesus wasn't born on December 25th. In fact, that's a pagan holiday that the church took over, and so we shouldn't celebrate Christmas. And I'm going to tell you, that is exactly right. Christmas, Jesus wasn't born on December 25th. If I ruined that for you, I apologize right now. He wasn't born on December 25th. He probably wasn't even born during this season of the year. And it is likely that, yes, this is compounded upon a pagan holiday understanding. That's because historically what the church did was say, you know what? They don't get all the good holidays. We're going to take it back. And so in opposition to the pagan holidays, what they did was develop a church holiday, if you will. And it was all in the name of remembering the sacrifices that were given by our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, instead of worrying about the sacrifices that the pagans would give to whatever thing that they were giving their sacrifices to, be that, just false gods or nature or what have you. And so there's my paraphrased holiday history for you, but I have to say this. I've been convicted lately. I was convicted as I was preparing for this message. I think holidays are good. I think Christmas is good. I think Miss Fern and Mr. Tom exhibited that very well in our children's sermon this morning, don't you? Because the gifts that are given are the best gifts that you could ever dream of. The very gift of Jesus Christ coming down to be with us. God with us. The literal transliteration of that word Emmanuel is actually with us is God. And I think it's important to understand it that way, especially because the great I am became with us God. That's huge. I don't know if you're big on words. I don't care. I don't know if you care about words so much, but when it's that intentional, it's important that we take note of it. Don't you agree? Can someone say amen to that? And so that was very intentional. And so as I think about it, I think the reality is that people need a reminder to stop what they were doing and focus upon the Lord. As I think about it, and as I thought about it yesterday, I understand people. And I understand our tendency, because this is my tendency, to be unreliable and undedicated to something, to the point where God can't even trust us to celebrate, to remember, and to devote ourselves daily, as Nate was praying a while ago, that every day should be Christmas. Every day should be Easter. Don't you agree? Every day should be a day of communion with the Father. But we are unreliable. We are undedicated. We are undevoted to the point to where we do so daily. And I realize that. I can't even tell my kids how much I love them on a daily basis, though I should. And I do love them. Very, very, very much. All four of them. I care about them a lot. And I can't even make myself tell them on a daily basis without getting irritated with them at some point during the day. Parents say amen to that. I can't even do that, let alone tell our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ how thankful I am for His gift. And so, here's my thoughts on Christmas. I need a reminder to stop. And it's not about the trees. It's not about the lights. It's not about the songs that we sing only during a specific 4 weeks of the year. It's not about that for me. It's about the fact that Jesus disrobed Himself from the holiness that He is in heaven and came down to be in the very same place that I am, to deal with the very same temptations that I deal with. We read about that in Sunday school this morning in Matthew chapter 4. To deal with temptations that I deal with on a physical and spiritual level. To deal with the very hurts and the very tears that I would shed on His own. It's that that comes to mind and is a reminder for me during the month of December, at the very least. Which should be something that happens not only every Sunday morning, but every day that I wake up and take a breath, the gift of breath, each day. Would you agree with me on this? That was totally a rabbit trail, but a very necessary one. And so this morning, I think about that, and therefore, special remembrance in the form of dedicated seasons such as Christmas and Easter are necessary as I think about that. And then as I think about it, I realize that people can overanalyze and they can begin to rely upon their own wisdoms and their own ways, and then they forsake the promises of God and His plan and His wisdom and His commitment to His promises. And so I would submit to you that this morning, as we look at the predicament that King Ahaz was dealing with in Isaiah chapter 7, as we look at that, it's important for us to remember that we are not far off from Him. And so this morning, late as it is, I want to light the first two candles of the Advent wreath as a reminder for us. And the first two candles represent two specific things for us in the Christian tradition. The first candle represents hope. And so we light the first candle pink candle to represent the hope that we have in the coming of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. And traditionally, it's to look back at the book of Isaiah and to realize the promises that are given. And so it's appropriate that we light the first candle this morning, though it should have been lit two Sundays ago. So that's my confession to you. The second candle represents something else. The second candle represents love. The very love of God that He had for us as His creation. Next week we'll have another candle to light. I'm catching up. You forgive me, don't you? You better. So, you're in church. Take your Bibles with me, would you please, and turn to the book of Isaiah and stand in honor of God's word. As we look at this, we're besieged ourselves. We are in deep, deep trouble. And now, God's people, I'll ask you, upon whom do you rely in times of trouble? Upon whom do you wait? Do you believe that God has a plan for you? And if you do not believe, understand this, you shall surely not last. Did you hear me? If you do not believe, you shall surely not last. That's not me saying this. That comes from the very book of Isaiah. We're just going to read a portion of it, and then we're going to come back to it. But I'm going to have you stand right now in honor of God's word, because he is worthy. We're going to read through the verse 12. Now it came about in the days of Ahaz, the son of Jotham, the son of Uzziah, king of Judah, that Rezin, the king of Aram, and Pekah, the son of Remaliah, king of Israel, went up to Jerusalem to wage war against it, but could not conquer it. Okay, so that's a lot of funky words that we just read. I'll come back to it to explain what's really happening here. And so they could not conquer it. When it was reported to the house of David, that's Ahaz, saying the Arameans have camped in Ephraim, that's Israel, his heart and the hearts of his people shook as the trees of the forest shake with the wind. And then the Lord said to Isaiah, go out now to meet Ahaz, you and your son Shear-Jashub, at the end of the conduit of the upper pool on the highway to the fuller's field, and say to him, take care and be calm. I told Mallory yesterday, she had a shirt on that said, be calm and something. You've seen that trend right now. Be calm and whatever, right? This is where it really should come from, right here. He says, take care and be calm. Be calm and do not fear is what it really says. And do not be faint-hearted because of these two stubs of smoldering firebrands, on account of the fierce anger of Rezin and Aram and the sons of Remaliah, because Aram with Ephraim and the son of Remaliah has planned evil against you, saying, let us go up against Judah and terrorize it and make for ourselves a breach in its walls and set up the son of Tabeel as king in the midst of it. And thus says the Lord God, it shall not stand, nor shall it come to pass. For the head of Aram is Damascus, and the head of Damascus is Rezin. Now within another 65 years, Ephraim will be shattered, so that it is no longer a people. And the head of Ephraim is Samaria, and the head of Samaria is the son of Remaliah. And if you will not believe, you shall surely not last. Then the Lord spoke again to Ahaz, saying, ask a sign for yourself from the Lord your God. Make it deep as Sheol and high as the heaven. But Ahaz said, I will not ask, nor will I test the Lord. May God bless the reading of his word. Amen? Amen. Would you please be seated? I want to back up just a moment. I want to explain what's going on here. It came about in the days of Ahaz. Okay, we last read about the king Uzziah. Okay, Ahaz is Uzziah's son. All right? He's king of Judah. Judah is the southern kingdom of all of Israel. Israel was 12 tribes, correct? Am I right? 12 tribes of Israel. When they set up in the promised land, 10 of the tribes were in the northern kingdom, and that became Israel proper, okay? The northern kingdom of Israel. The southern kingdom was developed from two different tribes. And of those tribes, they became the kingdom of Judah, the southern kingdom of Judah. King David was king of Israel, if you will. He was the one that God chose to lead all of Israel. Okay, King David genetically derived from the southern kingdom of Judah. Okay, the second great king in Israel. Can anyone name him? Solomon. You're exactly right. And so Solomon is the second greatest king in all of Israel. Can anyone name the third greatest king in all of Israel? Hezekiah. Hezekiah is the son of Ahaz. Okay? Ahaz is not counted as a great king in Israel. Ahaz, despite what sounds like a very pious answer to the Lord when God says, give me a test. Come on. Give me a test. Come on. Ask me anything. Anything you want. Make it as deep as hell or as high as the heaven. That's what Sheol is, hell. Make it as deep as hell or as high as the heavens. Go ahead. Ask me. Go ahead. And Ahaz responds with, no way. I'm not going to test the Lord God. He sounds so righteous, doesn't he? But I submit to you that he was not righteous. He seems not to want to bother God with this simple request. But we have to realize here that God directs Ahaz. God tells him, ask. In Matthew chapter 7, verses 7 and 8, God says to us, ask and it shall be given unto you. I know that because I learned a song when I was growing up. The first verse of that song said, seek ye first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and all these things shall be added unto you. Hallelujah, hallelujah. But no one knows the second verse. And the second verse says this from Matthew 7, 7 and 8. It says, ask and it shall be given unto you. Seek and ye shall find. Knock and it will be opened unto you. Hallelujah, hallelujah. How many knew the second verse? A few of us, see? So I thought about that as I was thinking about Ahaz, and God was saying, ask, ask, ask. And Ahaz so piously says, I shall not ask the Lord God of anything. I will not test him. That's probably how he sounded when he did it. Probably took that stance too, that Shakespearean stance. And then I was reminded, wait a minute, God told him to ask. I wonder how much it upset God. And then I wonder how much it upsets God when we don't ask. Because when we're asking of God, that means we're relying upon God. It doesn't mean he's going to give you what you ask for, though. Because you may not need what you ask for. But God wants you to ask because he wants you to have a relationship with him. Now, how many understand that this morning? God wants us to ask. God wants us to have a relationship with him. But it doesn't mean you're going to get it. So don't be upset. So when God tells you to ask, don't you think you should do so? But Ahaz wasn't being upright here. He wasn't. He was discounting God's direction. He was faithless here. In fact, if you look back to verse 9, you see why God would say that. If he says in New American Standard, if you will not believe, you surely shall not last. You have a different translation possibly. What does yours say? What's verse 9 say? Give me some different translations. NIV, anyone? Isn't that awesome? That is a great translation. And that came from Nancy McCauley, who does not like to speak in public. Whoop, whoop. I was listening to Nancy play the bass this morning, and we determined that it's all about that bass, no treble. And so, and Nancy was playing the bass this morning, and I must be emotional this morning because everything takes me to that verge of tears. And I got a little misty-eyed about Nancy. Because Nancy and I were in Fort Worth together. Nancy, Matt, Heather, and I, we were in Fort Worth together going to Hewlin Street Baptist Church. And I'm going to brag a little bit about me for a second. We were there during the transition from the typical piano and basic praise band to adding instruments. And I got to play bass in my recollection for the first time at Hewlin Street Baptist Church. And I can remember just, and I looked over at Nancy and I'm hearing her come through on the bass. Because when she first started playing bass, you couldn't even hear it come through. And Nancy, I could hear your bass. I could hear you just thumping away. Boom, boom. It sounded like the intro to Seinfeld. Boom, 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 boom. Anyway, she's just thumping away at it. And I'm so proud how God takes people who are willing to serve him and take them outside their comfort zone and do amazing things, because it's amazing when someone leads in worship, isn't it? It's amazing. And so proud of that. There's another rabbit trail this morning. Turn with me to 2 Kings chapter 16. 2 Kings chapter 16. How do I know that God was referring to the, if you do not have faith, you will not stand? How do I know that Ahaz wasn't being faithful here? Let's do this Paul Harvey thing and let's look at the rest of the story. 2 Kings chapter 16. Ooh, it's in here. I know it is. 2 Kings 16. Beginning in verse 1. Here's the background for you. Okay, so So what you need to understand, though, what's going on right now, the northern kingdom, Israel, has teamed up with the Arameans, who are a godless people, and have come to besiege. That means they've surrounded the country of Judah, the southern kingdom. They've surrounded it. They've besieged it. Nothing goes in. Nothing comes out. They're starving them out. They're thirsting them out. They're intending to defeat them. But what we just read in Isaiah says they could not defeat them. And so this is a more structured background, if you will, of what's happening in that moment. And in the 17th year of Pekah, the son of Remaliah, Ahaz, the son of Jotham, king of Judah, became king. Ahaz was 20 years old when he became king. He reigned 16 years in Jerusalem. He did not do what was right in the sight of the Lord his God, as his father David had done. But he walked in the way of the kings of Israel, and he even made his son pass through the fire. That's code word for he probably sacrificed one of his sons to a foreign god in the fire. That is not good, okay? According to the abominations of the nations whom the Lord had driven out from before the sons of Israel. He sacrificed and he burned incense on the high places and on the hills and under every green tree. And then Rezin, the king of Aram, and Pekah, the son of Remaliah, king of Israel, came up to Jerusalem to wage war. And they besieged Ahaz, but they could not overcome him. At that time, Rezin, king of Aram, recovered Elath for Aram. And he cleared the Judeans out of Elath entirely. And the Arameans came to Elath and have lived there to this day. Now Ahaz. So Ahaz sent messengers to Tiglath-Pileser, king of Assyria. This is where we get this part that he's not faithful. He's not really trusting God here. He's not really trying to say, I would not test the Lord God. It's because he had another plan. And here's his other plan. Tiglath-Pileser, king of Assyria, saying, I am your servant and your son. Come up and deliver me from the hand of the king of Aram and from the hand of the king of Israel, who are rising up against me. Ahaz took the silver and gold that was found in the house of the Lord. Did you catch that? He literally robbed the house of the Lord to pay tribute to Tiglath-Pileser, the king of the Assyrians. He paid him to come and protect him. Ahaz took the silver and gold that was found in the house of the Lord and in the treasuries of the king's house. He sent a present to the king of Assyria. So the king of Assyria listened to him. And the king of Assyria went up against Damascus, which was in the northern kingdom of Israel. And he captured it. And he carried the people of it away into the exile to Kir and to put Rezin to death. Now, Ahaz discounted God's offer for what he thought would be a sure thing. He made a deal with the Assyrians, the national power at that time. The Assyrians, consequently, would later be the ones who would take the northern kingdom of Israel around 722 BC, conquer the northern kingdom of Israel, and disperse God's people all throughout the land. It's called the dispersion. And so the northern kingdom of Israel was defeated and dispersed during this time right here that we're reading about. And so Ahaz even defiled God's altar in exchange for a seemingly sure thing. You'll read in just a little bit where he actually cut the horns off of the altar that were specifically placed there under God's direction for a specific purpose in worship and in the sacrifices that were given in that type of sacrificial worship. And so later, this supposed ally, the Assyrians, would be defeated by the Babylonians. And it is the Babylonian Empire that would eventually come and conquer the southern kingdom of Judah in 586 BC. So 722 BC, roughly, northern kingdom of Israel falls. 586 BC, southern kingdom of Judah falls. Any history buffs in here? One. There we go. So there you go, Miss Mary. So now you know. There's what happened. As far as that part goes. Verse 13, back in Isaiah chapter 7. Let's run back there. Ahaz would not fool God. God compares this situation. He says this, Listen now, O house of David. In other words, what he's saying is, listen up, Ahaz. If you want to gripe at someone, call them an ugly name, just call them Ahaz. That sounds rude, doesn't it? Listen up, Ahaz. That's what God said to him. Listen up, O house of David. Ahaz represented the house of David, the southern kingdom of Judah. Is it too slight a thing for you to try the patience of men that you will try the patience of God as well? Isaiah is saying this, and he says that you would try the patience of my God as well. And then he goes on to say something that you may be familiar with. Therefore, the Lord himself will give you a sign. Since you're not asking for one, I'm going to tell you what it's going to be anyway. And he says, behold, a virgin will be with child and bear a son, and she will call his name Emmanuel. He will eat curds and honey at the time he knows enough to refuse evil and choose good. For before the boy will know enough to refuse evil and choose good, the land whose two kings you dread will be forsaken. The Lord will bring on you, on your people, and on your father's house such days as you have never come since the day that Ephraim separated from Judah, the king of Assyria. In that day, the Lord will whistle for the fly that is in the remotest parts of the rivers of Egypt and for the bee that is in the land of Assyria. They will all come and they'll settle on the steep ravines, on the ledges of the cliffs, on all the thorn bushes and all the watering places. In that day, the Lord will shave with a razor hired from regions beyond the Euphrates, that is with the king of Assyria, the head and the hair of the legs, and it will also remove the beard. And what he's saying is he's using metaphor, and he's talking about these different countries that are going to come and occupy God's promised land to the people of Israel. Because they've been unfaithful, they will not stand. Do you see this? And so they are not standing. God's telling them, in the future, you're going to lose all of this that I've promised you. In that day, a man may keep alive a heifer and a pair of sheep. Because of the abundance of the milk produced, he will eat curds for everyone that is left within the land. We'll eat curds and honey. And that sounds like such a nice thing, doesn't it? Everybody likes to go to Culver's and get fried curds, right? No? That's fried cheese. What's wrong with that? In this case, it's bad, though it sounds good. Sounds like they've got an abundance of something. No, it's because all they have left, after everything's been taken, all they have left are milk-producing animals. And so all they can do. Can you imagine if all you could survive on was curds and honey? That's the only diet you had because that's all that was left to you? It's not an abundant supply. It's an abundant supply of stuff they don't want, and they'll get tired of it. It will come about in that day, verse 23, that every place where there used to be 1,000 vines valued at 1,000 shekels of silver will become briars and thorns. That means everything that you've grown, all the grapes that you have used, all the crops that you've grown and have survived on, no more. There's going to be thorns and thistles there because there will be no more. People will come there with bows and arrows because they're coming to hunt, but they're not going to find anything, is what he's saying. People will come with bows and arrows because all the land will be briars and thorns. And as for all the hills which used to be cultivated with a hoe, will not go there for fear of briars and thorns, but they will become a place for pasturing oxen and for sheep to trample. Isaiah just gave a very poignant prophecy. Behold, the virgin will give birth to a baby. She will call his name Emmanuel. There's argument after argument about this passage. I'll give you three summaries of this argument. That this passage was written for that time only. That was it. That's all it was for. The second argument, that there's a duality of meaning. That means it has two specific meanings, and that means it was for that time and for a future time. And the third argument is that it was only for the future time, the obvious time that we can understand, the thought that you and I are having now, because here we are looking back. It was only for that time that was written about in Matthew chapter 1, verse 23. But I would argue that it's not for that time only. That can be ruled out fairly easily. I don't even have to argue that. And it's not for future only because Ahaz will see the result of his lack of faith. And God summarizes it through Israel or Isaiah right here. And you see it more in chapter 8 and chapter 9. You see about that. But I will tell you that the duality of meaning does hold merit. The young maiden or the virgin that we read about here was probably in earshot of Isaiah as he was listing off this prophecy to them, probably in earshot. And some would say that possibly with child at that moment. Think about that just a minute. Isaiah is listing off this prophecy, and it's possible, I'm not saying it's for sure, I'm just saying it's possible, this is one of the arguments, that the young virgin or the young maiden was in earshot at that time. Ahaz likely knew of whom Isaiah was speaking of at that time, and possibly could have been referring to Hezekiah, the third greatest king of all of Israel. Possibly the third most righteous could be the one that was prophesied in that specific time. Verses 18 through 25 seems to speak of abundance with this curds and honey, but I already told you about that. It's not necessarily a good thing. And we know that the crops will dry up in verse 23. We know that the hunting will be of little reward in verse 24. But the overarching theme of this passage for you and I, that is the context in which it was written. But the overarching theme and how it applies to your life today is where the Messiah is to come. And the best commentary of all of Scripture, I can tell you what all the commentators say because I read through many of them in preparation for this today. I can tell you what most of the commentators are saying and the common arguments among them. I just summarized for you right there. But I'm going to tell you this right now. It doesn't matter what all the commentaries say. It doesn't matter what I say to you in regards to this. What matters is what God's Word says about God's Word. And so if you ever have a question about God's Word, if it seems like it's contradicting to you, then you should continue to read God's Word because God's Word explains God's Word. Amen? And so if you look in Matthew chapter 1, verse 23, you can see the best commentary for Isaiah chapter 7, verse 14 is Matthew chapter 1, verse 23. And this is where you see that the gospel writer references the very passage that we're referring to today. And it tells me something. It tells me that the historical significance is that God has an everlasting plan for his chosen people. The genetic significance is that if Ahaz were defeated in that time and he were killed, the very birth line of Jesus Christ that you read about in all of the first chapter of Matthew, the very birth line of Jesus from King David will have been interrupted. And there's a problem with that, you see, because we know that Jesus is a son of David from his genetic side, from his earthly genetic side, okay? But the spiritual significance is huge. When one realizes that God shows what can happen, that if you will just have faith in him, you will see that he has plans to complete his promises. If you will not have faith, you will surely not last. See, we've looked at both directions on this. We looked in the past for Ahaz, and now we've looked at the future. This season of Advent is a reminder that we have hope. The very same as described by the prophet Isaiah. We also have love, which is incomparable in that God would send his son, born of a virgin and unique in every way, and that we may all be saved. And not just Israel, but even us Gentiles. We are adopted into the family of God because of Emmanuel with us. Is God. I'm going to ask you to stand with me. I'm going to ask the praise team to come. I'm going to ask Chip to come forward. He's going to be here. And Matt will be in the back. Chip will be here to receive you and pray with you and let you know that you're not alone. Matt will be in the back to receive you and talk with you if you need to talk. It's loud up here, so it's best to go to the back to talk. And so, this would leave you with this. Ahaz made the mistake of relying upon what he could see right in front of him. Do you see that in this story? He relied upon what he could see right in front of him. And I don't want you to make that mistake. Verse 9 says, if you will not believe, you will surely not last. I'm going to ask you this morning, why not believe today? Spit everywhere. Why not? Why not believe today? You've got nothing of significance to lose by believing. But without faith, you will lose everything. Amen? So why not today? Pray with me. Father God, thank you for your word. Thank you for Jesus, the best gift. Thank you for your love and your care for us. Thank you, Father, that we can look at your word and find answers. So God, in this moment, as we have this time of invitation, would you move in the hearts of your people? Stir within them. Allow them to realize that without you, they have nothing. With you, they can have everything. Praise you, God, in this moment. Thank you for your deep love for us. The invitation is open, church. How will you respond?